Hello dear all. So in this presentation we discuss the fundamental laws of homeopathy as given in Robert's philosophy. First is law of cure. All of us know that the homeopathy is based on similia similibus curantur, means let likes be treated by likes. So similar disease in the patient is removed by the similar remedy which produces the same set of symptoms in the brewers. Thus similia similibus curantur, where the matching is done, matching of the medicine which has produced same set of symptoms in the brewer with the symptoms seen in the patient, then we can administer that remedy which is called as similimum, based on similia similibus curantur, means let likes be treated by likes. Hering has given the law of cure. It means cure takes place from above downwards, from within outwards, from more important organs to less important organs, and in the reverse order of the onset of symptoms. So cure should be from above downwards. What is above downwards? It should be from head to toe, from within outwards, means from center to periphery, means the cure should first take place in the functioning of the internal organs and then on of the skin. The more important organs to less important organs, means also the more important organs are the vital organs and less important organ is skin, hair and appendages. So first cure should be in the more important vital organs. And the most important is it should be from mind to body, means the mental symptom should first ameliorate, followed by the symptoms of the body, and in the reverse order of the onset of the symptoms, means the symptoms which appear first are last to go. So reverse order of the appearance of the symptoms. So we go further. Therapeutic law of nature given in aphorism number 26. The weaker dynamic affection is permanently extinguished by a stronger one, very similar to manifestations but differing in kind. So example of natural cures is given, that is patient suffering from ophthalmia, if he gets smallpox, then ophthalmia is cured, ophthalmia is removed by smallpox, but the disease smallpox remains. So stronger similar disease removes the weaker similar disease in the nature. Second is law of action. Action and reaction are equal and opposite. Action of similar remedy, it is related with the action of similimum. So action of similimum is according to the law of action, that is action and reaction are equal and opposite, means the action of the similimum remedy, that it produces artificial similar stronger disease in the patient and it takes the natural disease away in the opposite direction and frees the individual from the natural disease. Law of quantity and dose. So third law described, law of quantity and dose. the quantity of the drug required is in inverse ratio to the similarity. Means what? Higher the similarity, higher the potency. The rule of selection of the potency is that higher the similarity of the remedy with the totality, higher is the potency. So, matching of the remedy with the totality is done, then higher potency is selected. And where is this matching first done? It is at the level of mind. So, the higher the similarity, higher the potency. So, higher the potency means less is the quantity of drug. Hence, quantity of drug required is in inverse proportion to the similarity. Higher the similarity, higher the potency. And as the potency increases, the quantity of drug substance decreases. Fourth is the law of quantity. The quantity of action necessary to effect any change in nature is the least possible. This law is given by French mathematician Maupertuis. The extension of this law is given by Fink. The decisive amount is always minimum and infinitesimal. It means what? For any phenomena in the nature takes place by a very small quantity of action. So, the phenomena may be extensive, but the stimulus, that is the action, is required in very small quantity. So, for example, the tsunami waves are 700 to 800 meters in height. They are produced at the seashore. But what is the cause? The cause is in the center of the ocean. And the cause is the millimeter displacement of the tectonic plates of the earth. So, the cause is in the quantity of millimeter. But what is the phenomena we observe? It is the phenomena of tsunami waves of 700 to 800 meters high waves. Here it is related with the phenomena of disease and phenomena of cure. So, phenomena of disease is because of the quantity of action is in the dynamic form. So, it is very subtle. So, the causes of disease we are accepting in homeopathy as dynamic causes. So, the cause, even say for example tuberculosis, the quantity of tubercular bacilli cannot be counted. They are very small in number. We say it as droplets. So, quantity of action necessary to produce any phenomena is always minimum, least possible. So, the causes of the diseases are dynamic. The cure takes place also by dynamic remedies. And how much is the quantity present in our remedies is in the dynamic form, minimum, because as we are going to increase the potency, it is higher the dilutions and lesser is the quantity of drug. And of how much lesser? It is infinitesimal, infinitely small. So, the quantity cannot be measured now. So, quantity of action necessary to effect any change in nature is the least possible. It is explained in the phenomena of disease and phenomena of cure. the decisive amount is minimum, always infinitesimal, means infinitely small, very small, subtle or dynamic in nature. Fifth is the law of quality. The quality of action of homeopathic remedy is determined by quantity in inverse ratio. The quality of action of homeopathic remedy is determined by its quantity in inverse ratio. Means higher the similarity, higher the quality, and lesser is the quantity. So it is the inverse proportion of quantity and quality. So higher the similarity, higher is the potency, and as the potency increases, the quantity of drug substance decreases. Sixth law described is law of use. The dose and quantity that will thoroughly permeate the organism and its essential impression upon the vital force is that which will affect functional sphere of the individual. So, what is that dose and quantity? And where it should affect? It should affect the organism, means it should affect its vital energy. The sphere of vital energy is the functional sphere. And what do we understand by functional sphere? It means the general symptoms of the patient are first affected, that is mental generals and physical generals. This functional sphere is in the dynamic form. We cannot see the mental symptoms, neither we can touch the mental symptoms. Similarly, the physical generals, that is appetite, thirst, craving, aversions, such symptoms are also dynamic form. They are not visible, neither they can be touched. So, these are the sensations of the patient, very near to the patient. This indicates the functional sphere. This indicates the symptoms which are of the vital energy, life energy. So, the life energy, if it should have been affected, it should have been by the doses of the remedy in the dynamic form. So, the dose and quantity that will affect the life energy are in the dynamic form. And the symptoms of the life energy are nothing but, first, most important, the general symptoms, that is mental generals and physical generals. Seventh law is the law of biological development. Function creates and develops the organs. So always there is necessity of function, and then automatically nature starts preparing for its necessity. So function creates and develops the organ. So what it means further, that is given in the eighth law, that is law of disease development. Functional symptoms are produced by the vital force in exact proportion to the profundity of the disturbance. So, how much is the disturbance of the life energy? The most important affected are the functional symptoms. Functional symptoms precede the structural changes. Means what? Structural changes comes after the changes in the functional symptoms. General symptoms are nothing but functional symptoms of the patient. They are very near to him. Emotions are very near to the individual, so as his cravings and aversions. Particular symptoms are the organ affections. They denote the pathology. So always it is the rule that functional symptoms precedes the structural changes. Ninth law is of drug proving. It is given in the three headings. Any drug which in its natural state affects the vital energy but little means very small. So that drug will develop a proving only in a high potency. Example, sand. Sand does not have any effect in its natural state on our vital energy. But the remedy prepared from sand, that is silica. So it is the law given, it will develop a proving in a high potency. Let's see the second law of drug proving. Any drug in its natural state disturbs the vital energy to functional manifestations only may be proven in a crude form. So example, common salt. Common salt we are taking daily and it has the affection of the vital energy in its natural state. So remedy prepared is natromure. Or the other example is allium sepa, where we are taking the onions every day. The remedy prepared from onion is allium sepa. So such remedies can be proved in a crude form, but we never give the crude form to the provers. We prove the drugs in a potentized form. Third is the law of proving. Any drug which in its natural state disturbs the vital energy to destructive manifestations should be proven only in a potentized form. Thus, snake venom. So, snake venom has action on our vital energy in its natural state, that the destructive manifestations are produced. The snake venom of, say, cobra snake is fatal. So, snake venoms, the remedy prepared is lachesis. So, such remedy should be always given in a potentized form, never in a crude form, because it is fatal to the individual. So, any drug which in its natural state disturbs the vital energy to destructive manifestations should be proved in a potentized form. So, 10th law is given of repetition. It is given under two headings. Law of proving, law of repetition in drug proving, and law of repetition in cure. So, let's see first in the drug proving. So, never repeat the dose while symptoms are manifested from the dose already taken. So, this is sequential method of drug proving, where we are giving the first dose and then if the symptoms are produced, we are not repeating. So we can know the order of appearance of symptoms. So while the first dose has been produced in some action, the symptoms are manifested in the prover, then the next dose is not repeated. Law of repetition for cure. Never repeat your remedy so long as it continues to act. It means what? You, after the administration of the remedy, so as long as there is amelioration, don't repeat. So never repeat your remedy so long as it continues to act. So as long as there is amelioration, don't repeat. These are the fundamental laws given in the Robert's philosophy. Thank you.